Come on, everybody, you know this, you're all I need. Every breath you breathe through me, you're all I need. Let your rivers flow. You're all I need. Every breath you breathe, you're all I need. Let your rivers. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, let's praise him in the sanctuary this morning. If ever there was a time, we need him, because he is the air that we breathe. We are so grateful to God to be back in the sanctuary. Hallelujah. If you came to give God glory and honor and praise this morning, give him some praise in the sanctuary. We do bless the Lord for our pastor, Dr. Byron Brazier, who is taking a break. He took his wife away for her 65th birthday. Amen. Amen. They went to Maui. Praise God. We pray that God will bless them as they relax and enjoy the beach and the ocean and the sunshine. And that God will bring them back renewed, restored, with a fresh word for us. Continue to pray for Elder Robert J. McGee Sr. He is still in the hospital, but he's doing well. He needs our prayers continuously. He's always looking forward to your visits and your calls. And his mind is sharp. Hallelujah. It is his desire to be here with us. But let's continue to keep him lifted in prayer. All of those that are sick, those that are shut in, those that are undomiciled, those that are in need of employment, let's pray that God will bless them. How many know that it's me standing in the need of prayer? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not my mother, not my father, not my sister, not my brother. It's me standing in the need. Pastor always admonishes us to pray for the person in front, behind, and on side. Why don't you just take somebody by the hand? Remember our president. Remember his staff. Remember the leaders of our city and our country. Pray a special prayer for our youth. But let us pray for this service, that God's presence will be prevalent. God blessed us with 7 souls in the first service. Pray that God will heal, deliver, and set free in this service. Dr. Porter will lead us in prayer.
Let every heart pray. Gracious Father, it's in the name of Jesus that we come. We first of all say thank you, and we bless you, we honor you, we extol you, and we lift you up. We acknowledge your sovereignty and your great grace, for you are our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords, and we are grateful this morning and give you all praise. We worship you, and we bless your name. Father, during this time of prayer, we lift up those requests that have gone up. You heard those that were unspoken because you heard our hearts. You know the needs that your people have today, and we know that you are a prayer-answering God. Father, we ask that you would bless our pastor as he and First Lady travels. Keep them, protect them, grant, keep your angels charge over them. Lord, remember Elder McGee, Father. Keep him and be that very present help for him, even in this time of healing and restoration. Father, we pray a special blessing upon our service on this morning, this afternoon. We ask, Lord, that you would send forth your anointing that destroys every yoke. Father, bring and send forth your spirit, Lord, to move by your spirit. Send forth healing, deliverance in the name of Jesus, and set the captives free. We bind the enemy even right now in the name of Jesus, that he will have no way in this service, but we'll be careful to give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, saints. Our morning scripture reading comes from Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 39. Let us all read together. And the same day, when the even was come, he saith unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him, and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked.
Together for our choir, our minister of music, Brother Chip Johnson, our organ.
I wanna be so close. The reason I see you every day is 'cause I wanna know you. I wanna know you. The reason I read your word as much as I do is because I wanna know everything about you. I wanna know you in your strength, your power, and mind. Lord, I'm asking you that you give me spiritual sight. I wanna know the things that bring you honor and praise. I wanna feel the things across my hands to raise. More than just the words I read on every page. Lord, I wanna know, yeah. I wanna be so close. The reason I seek you every day is 'cause I wanna know you. I wanna know you. Second verse. I heard about your love and grace and your power that saves. I heard about your mercies that I knew every day. I heard about the awesome sacrifice that you paid. Lord, I know that you're deserving of my highest praise. I want to know the things that give you honor and praise.
But what you've done for others, for me, you'll do the same thing too. But it's just not enough for me to hear about you. Lord, I wanna know you. I wanna know you. I wanna be so close. The reason I seek you every day is 'cause I wanna know you. I wanna know you. Let me teach you this part. I really wanna know you. I really wanna know you. I really wanna know you, know you, Lord, in a very real way. I really wanna know ya, good God. I really wanna know ya, oh yeah. I really wanna know ya, know ya, know ya. Can you help me say I really wanna know ya? Really wanna know ya. I wanna know ya. Hey, ha, hey. I really wanna know ya. Really wanna know ya. In a very real way. Well, I know all about you. Lord, I really want to know. In a very real way. Just like the woman at the well. You gave her living water. And she ran on the tail. Oh, I really want to know you. Just like the three Hebrew boys. When they got thrown in the fire. They trusted in the Lord. I wanna know you. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, hey, hey. In a very real way. 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 Lord, take hold of my heart. In a very real way. Take hold of my mind. In a very real way.
Hallelujah.
I want you to just worship the Lord with us this morning. Hallelujah. A little simple song. I will be with you. Come on, you can sing with us. That's all it is. I will be with you. Anybody need God to be with them today? I will be with you.
I will be with you.
Jesus said, I'll be with you.
I will
oh, yes, I will.
Be with you.
If you will only trust me. Jesus said, I'll never leave you.
I'll never leave you.
Come on in the balcony, join in with us. I'll never leave you.
I'll never
oh,
leave you.
I'll never leave you. Jesus said it.
I'll never
leave you. If you alone.
Trust me,
just trust in me. I'll walk alongside of you, yes. I'll never leave you. Just trust me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And then he says, I'll fight your battles. Anybody got any battles you need to fight for you? Yes, he will. You don't have to do it for yourself. God said, I'll fight. The battle is not yours, it's the Lord. Say that one more time. Come on, sing that with us. I'll fight your battle.
I'll fight your battle.
Anybody need God to fight a battle for them?
I'll fight your battle.
Jesus said, I'll fight the battle. It belongs to me. Trust him on this morning. I'm like Brother Hunt. The Spirit of the Lord is moving today and moving on our hearts just to trust him more and more. In our 9 o'clock service, we had the privilege of hearing from one of our assistant pastors, Elder Ronald Smith, coming out of Psalms 117, and he encouraged us to praise him. And at this afternoon service, we have the privilege of hearing from another one of our assistant pastors. She's a worshiper in her own right, one that this church loves dearly. She's been in leadership, appointed as an assistant pastor by Bishop Brazier, good 12 years ago, has been a role model for me and other ministers of this church. Over our personal services department, cares for you, prays for you when there's pastoral care and personal service needs. Won't you stand to your feet and give God praise for none other than one of our assistant pastors, evangelist Ivory Jean Knuckles.
Oh, if you trust me.
Yeah. Come on, let's tell the Lord. Lord said, I will be with you.
If you will only trust
me.
Come on, sing that with me.
Trust me.
Oh, yes.
Trust me.
Late in the midnight hour, when it seems nobody understands.
Trust me.
Come on, say that one more time.
If you will only
trust me.
Trust me.
Hallelujah. 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 Oh, God, I feel like I could run all over this pulpit this morning. Whenever you prepare to minister to God's people, I do. I always ask God for a confirmation. And my husband did not know what I was preaching today. The minister of music did not know. My brother did not know, but God knew. Today I am honored and blessed to be here, honor my boyfriend, my wonderful husband. I embarrass him, but he's been good to me. And I don't want him to be laying out front and then I come up here and talk about how good he is and what all he's done for me. I want him to know now how much I love and appreciate him. Yes. Because very few men will take in your grandmother and your mother. Very few. And never murmur and never complain as if it was his own mother and his own grandmother. And I'm grateful because my grandmother was sick in my home for 12 years in a hospital bed. And my husband never, ever complained about anything. And so I'm grateful for the 41 years that I've had with him. I'm trying to catch up with you, Sister Brazier. I do honor our pastor in his absence to my mother and my wonderful family, to this great ministerial alliance who was led by our assistant pastor, Dr. Porter, to all of the ministers and evangelists in the audience, and to Sister Isabel Brazier. Hallelujah. We honor you today. We know this is a special month for you, and we honor you today. Hallelujah. I would like for the musicians to continue to play that song because it is my subject matter today. The word of the Lord comes from 2 Samuel 22. 1-4. And I have a companion scripture in Psalms 125:1. 2 Samuel 22:1-4. Trust me. If you will only. I still hear pages turning, so I'm going to ask the musicians to continue to play that song. I pray that it will resonate in your spirit. 2 Samuel 22. If you have it, say amen. If you don't, say wait. Okay. All right. It's right after Ruth. Joshua judges Ruth. 2 Samuel 22, 1 through 4 reads in your hearing. And David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of all of his enemies and out of the hand of Saul. And he said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress. Hallelujah. Oh God. He is my rock and my fortress, my deliverer, the God of my rock. In him will I trust. You might want to underline that. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. Companion scripture, Psalms 125, verse number 1. They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abideth forever. The subject matter comes from 2 Samuel 22 and 3 and Psalms 125 and 1. My subject matter this morning, very simple. We've been singing it all morning. Trust in the Lord. God has a way of doing things. My husband always said, what are you preaching? I don't know, I'm not sure. But God knows. And if ever there was a time that we needed to trust in the Lord, it is now. You really can't depend on being on a job 20, 30 years anymore. Really doesn't matter how much tenure you have. Doesn't matter how much money you have in the bank, how much is in your 401k. Doesn't matter how many lunches you have with the boss. If you live in a time and a place where you're depending on something or someone other than the Lord, you're headed for doom and destruction. The Bible says that we should trust in the Lord. In other words, it suggests that it is someone that we need to depend on other than something or someone else. The book of Samuel are two historical books of the Old Testament. And they cover the nations of Israel's transition from a lost tribal form of government to a united kingdom under Saul and David. The books are named after the prophet Samuel, who anointed these two leaders, Saul and David. Saul was the king of Edom. He was a Benjamite and the son of Kish. Saul was jealous of David. I want you to note that, because we have a lot of jealousy and envy going on. Saul envied him because he was blessed and highly favored. You ever met people that just don't like you? They don't know nothing about you. They just don't like you. They don't even know your name, and they don't like you. They don't like the way you dress. They don't like the way you walk. They don't like the way you fix your hair. Envy and jealousy. But you get happy over the song when you sing, "What God has for me, it is for me." David was blessed and highly favored by God. Saul tried to kill David, But Saul's son, Jonathan, his own flesh and blood, interceded on behalf of David. Jonathan's father was very angry. You can imagine that he was very angry and very upset. You would think that he would stand by his father's side, but he knew what his father was doing was not right. His loyalty was to David and not his father. Saul, the Bible said, pursued David. He pursued him to the wilderness of Ziph. And even though Saul tried to kill David, David was the very one that spared his life. Have you ever noticed that sometimes those that really talk about you or say they don't like you or point fingers, those are the very ones that come to you in time of need. Want you to pray for them. Want to know if you can stand by their side. The Bible says that David was the king of Israel. He was a shepherd. He was also a warrior. And he was a worshiper. You have to be a warrior and a worshiper in this day and time. David, the Bible says he killed that uncircumcised Philistine, that giant. He killed the lion. He killed the bear. But the Bible says that David was anointed king while he was youth. In other words, David was chosen. He was appointed. And he was empowered by God. Tell somebody he was chosen, he was empowered, and he was appointed by God. Is there anybody here this morning that's been chosen, appointed, and empowered by God? David, name mean beloved. David was the second king of the United Kingdom of the Hebrew people. He was an ancestor of Jesus. He was also an outstanding minstrel, not just a musician, but a minstrel. David was exposed to the governmental affairs. It was a task that prepared him for his later service and assignment as king of Israel. The Bible said that David was a servant of the living God. I love that. He was a servant. It didn't say he was a bishop. Didn't it say he was a prophet or an apostle? It said he was a servant of the living God. The Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. David's mother alone was remembered for her godliness. He was a shepherd boy that rose and became the most famous king in Judah. How many know that God takes ordinary people and does extraordinary things? One songwriter said, little becomes much when you place it in the master's hand. It was in the wilderness of Ziph that he was betrayed by Saul. You know that it has often been a lot of times when God's people even find themselves in the midst of their enemies. You find yourself in imminent danger, even falling into the hands of your enemy. And whether you know it or not, we all got some enemies. Whether we like it or not, it doesn't matter. We've got some. Those people that smile in your face and talk about you behind your back. And I know I'm not the only one that's got some. It doesn't matter what you say or what you do. But the word of the Lord said, God will make your enemies your footstool. David, the Bible says he was not after men's heart, he was after God's heart. He did not care what the people thought. He didn't care what they said. He didn't care what they did. As long as he pleased his God, David did not matter about the accusation. The people, the Bible said, and Saul hated him, and they sought to destroy him. Saul was one of his main enemies. He was so malicious. He was so vindictive. He was more powerful than any of them that came up against him to destroy him. David loved his God. And he didn't care about his haters because he knew that his God was going to take care of him. David knew that those that trusted in God would always find a very present help in the time of danger. David went out because he trusted God. But even when God always delivered him, David always took time out. Elder Smith preached this morning. He always took time out to praise God and to thank God for what he had done. So many times we forget to take time out just to say thank you. So many times God does things for us, we take it for granted, like God's supposed to do that for us. God don't owe you anything. You were created in his image to give him glory and to give him honor. And there's one thing about David. Every time God did something for him, David found himself praising and worshiping God. David had haters, though, that sought his ruin. And you have people that don't want to see you to succeed. They don't want to celebrate with you. There are some people that are satisfied as long as you're not prospering. They are content with you staying in a box. But let God start blessing you. Let God start opening doors for you. Let God start raising you up and giving you favor. You will find that your friends will be few. It is at this time that David was concerned with the fact that his enemies were so determined to destroy him. But we have to learn, just like David learned, that regardless of our circumstances and situation, we can find that God will be a present help even when we're faced with dangers and enemies. God honors those that put their trust in him. I hear the words of the Lord saying, God will be your refuge. He will be your mighty fortress. For it is in him that I will trust. David, from his own experience, has given us an assurance today that though our afflictions and our tests and our trials be many, we can trust in the Lord that he will bring us out of all of them. I don't care what it looks like in your life this morning. I don't care what you are going through this morning. I don't care what is causing your blood pressure to rise. I came by to tell you this morning that if you trust in God, he will sustain you. If you trust in God, even though your house is in foreclosure, God will give a song of praise in your spirit. Even if you don't know where your next meal is going to come from, he said he may not come when you want him, but how many know God is always on time? David understood that he was in great danger. His enemies rose up against him. Yes, just like David, we will have trouble. We will have enemies. Tell somebody, you will have them. You will have them. The Bible said that man is born of a woman of a few days and full of trouble. In other words, that passage in the Bible suggests that if you live, you will have trouble. If you live, you will have some enemies, some haters, if you please, those that drink haterade. You will have, if you live, you're going to have some disappointments. If you live, somebody's going to break your heart. Ah, but God is a heart fixer and a mind regulator. Get up and shake yourself off, baby. Don't lose your mind. Because there's somebody else coming along you're going to need it for. If you live, you're going to suffer some pain. If you live, you're going to lose some friends. You're going to lose some loved ones. You're going to lose some health, and you're going to lose some finances. The subject suggests that if you live, at some point of time, you're going to need a doctor. You're going to be sick in your body. If you live, you're going to have some financial difficulties. If you live, you're going to have some problems in your marriage. I have them. We all got them. If you're married, you got some problems. Don't sit there like you ain't got no problems in your marriage. You ain't got no perfect marriage. Marriage is like an EKG. You got some valleys just like you got some mountains. The challenge comes when you don't flatline. Don't flatline. But if you live, you're going to have some problems. But I came to tell you, you can make it through the valleys, through the problems. You can make it if you trust in the Lord. I hear the word of the Lord saying, the Lord is my rock and my fortress. He is my deliverer. He is my God. In him will I trust. He is and will be my shield. He'll be the horn of my salvation. He'll be my high tower. He'll be your refuge. And when you're lost, God will be your savior. The Bible says he will save you from violence. I will call upon the Lord. I have to call upon the Lord. I must call upon the Lord because he is worthy to be praised. Your enemy can be a person. The devil wants you to think it's just a person. Your enemy can be a person. It can be a place, or it can be a thing. It is anything that comes to harm you, destroy you, or take you out. The devil is your enemy. Make no mistake about it. Tell somebody he hates you. He hates you. He knows how to disguise himself in many different forms to deceive you. He knows how to package himself so you will think it's not him. But the devil is a liar. When you have intimacy with God, when you know how to trust him, that's why you've got to have a prayer life. Because your prayer life is like a radar. A radar detects everything that comes into its circumference. When you got intimacy with God like David did, the devil can disguise himself any way he wants to. But when he sticks his ugly head up, you can look him in the face and say, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. You have no power here. You have no authority. I don't care what form or how you disguise yourself. Because I have relationship with him. Oh God, I feel him in here. The devil wants to destroy you. He wants to deceive you. The Bible says he comes to kill, steal, and destroy. In other words, he wants to render you totally inoperative. Tell somebody he wants to take you out. The devil wants to take you out. Tell somebody else he wants to take you out. Don't think because you save and shout and speak in tongues that the devil don't want you. If you don't shout and speak in tongues, he don't want you. Because even the devil don't want nobody that have no worth. Oh, but if you got worth this morning, understand he wants to take you out. Don't play with the devil. The Bible says if you submit yourselves therefore to God, don't try and do battle with him. The Bible says do what? Resist him. And he will do what? He will flee from you. We have got to learn, like David, how to trust in God at all times. You can trust him in the good times. It's easy to trust him when you got food on your table, when you've got food in your pantry, when you've got money in the bank. But can you trust him when there's no food in the refrigerator? Can you trust him when all of your funds have run out? Can you trust him when you've been on your job 10, 12, 15, 20 years and they come and give you a termination notice? Can you trust him then? You can trust him when you're well, but can you trust him when you get a bad report from the doctor? Oh, God, I've been there and I've learned how to trust him. Can you trust him when all your funds have been depleted? Hallelujah. The Bible says we should trust in the Lord with all of our heart, with all of our mind, and with all of our soul. So we should lean not to what? In other words, your mind can't figure it out. You're not educated enough. You're not articulated enough. You don't have enough words in your vocabulary. But he said, if you trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in some of your ways, in the ways you think you can handle it. He said, in all of your ways, if you acknowledge him, he might, maybe, he will direct your path. Somebody ought to shout glory. Hallelujah. The songwriter said, my brother sang it this morning. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus said the Lord. The songwriter went on to say, I'm so glad I've learned to trust him. Put a pin in that right there. When you learn something, it means you've been taught a lesson. And you can't be taught a lesson unless you go through something. Everybody want a testimony. Everybody want to be anointed. But nobody want to go through anything. In order to trust Jesus, you got to go through something. So God can teach you how to stand. God can teach you how to be strong. God can teach you how to be steadfast and unmovable. He said, I've learned how to trust him. Precious Jesus, he'll be your savior and your friend. And I know that thou art with me. He will be with me until the end. He said, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him. Put a pin in that. When you prove something, it means that you've tried it over and over and over and over and over again. In other words, if God did it for you then, he'll do it for you today. If he did it for you today, he'll do it for you tomorrow. If it proves, it means it will work. The reason you keep doing it, because it's been proven. It will work. If you trust him, God won't let you down. In distress, God will be your deliverer. In your attack, he will be your shield. When you are pursued, like Saul pursued David, God, the Bible say, will be your refuge. When you are